Morning. Today we're going to look at a couple of lessons this morning and this evening about service. We're going to look at it in a couple different ways. Tonight we're going to look at the what. This morning we're going to look at how reasonable service to God is and kind of what God expects us to have is toward the attitude toward our service. So in Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, Apostle Paul writes, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service. Now, a lot of the newer translations will say spiritual worship there. I don't like the way they lump worship into this. There's a saying that if something is everything, that it ends up being nothing. So if everything that we do in life is worship, then worship really becomes nothing. It's not going to make any difference. I think we have to understand that there are times that we come together to worship, and then there are things that we do in service to God that are not necessarily worship, but they're still actions that we do toward our God and for our God. So I believe that's what Paul is talking about here in presenting our bodies as a living sacrifice, not just in the sense of being here this morning to worship God, but as we walk through life, we're to continually remember who our God is and what we're doing in serving Him. You okay, thank you? And he goes on to say, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. So when the Apostle Paul talks about the reasonable service, or at least a service that is acceptable to God, it is reasonable because God has never commanded an unreasonable service from anybody. And he doesn't expect us to make unreasonable or do unreasonable acts of service toward him. Even though there are sometimes it looks extreme what God is asking people, it really isn't, because God knows the outcome before he even begins the process. For example, Abraham. Think some of the things that went on with Abraham, not just in his worship, but in his day-to-day actions with God. And God tells him to leave his home and go down to another place to live. That was not unreasonable. Now, Abraham may have thought it was unreasonable for a while. Other people might have thought it was unreasonable, but God knew what the end was going to be if Abraham would do it. So it really was reasonable what God was asking. And even in the case of when Abraham was told to take Isaac up to Mount Moriah and offer him as a sacrifice, that really seemed unreasonable to a lot of people. And still, as we read it, it'll sometimes seem unreasonable to us. But we know that God had a plan. God was checking to see how far Abraham would be willing to go in serving him. And when God found out the answer, he stopped it. He wasn't going to allow him to kill or sacrifice, offer Isaac. So it wasn't unreasonable. Sometimes God puts us in a test. Sometimes God will put us between that rock and the hard place to see what type of people we are going to be. But he expects a presentation of our bodies as well as our talents. Even in that, it's reasonable in view of the reward that awaits us. The reward that we have when this life is over makes anything that God asks us to do reasonable. Now, how how reasonable is God's service? The reasonableness of it is found in several different things. Number one, it's reasonable because it's an exclusive service. An exclusive service. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, Jesus explains that no one can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. He cannot serve God and the English Standard says money. A lot of the older translations will say mammon, and that's kind of like the worldly. It's kind of almost putting an idol there. Like mammon, that just sounds like an idol, doesn't it? That people would worship. You can't worship God and you can't worship an idol at the same time. And you can't mix it, interchange it. Because once you start worshiping or serving that idol, then you've left God. You've departed from Him. Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all of these things will be added to you. What are all those things? All the things you need. All the things you need. Now, what's been talked about in that passage was like clothing and food and things of that nature. So, God will take care of us. Doesn't mean we don't have a part to play in it, an action, a lifestyle that we've got to participate in the right way to get this accomplished. But seek the kingdom first. And God's righteousness first puts everything else in order in our lives. Because that's the starting point. And in Luke chapter 4 and verse 8, Jesus answered the question of a man. It is written, he's answering Satan, you shall worship the Lord your God, and Him only shall you serve. So not only do we worship our God, we must serve our God. So it's reasonable, and again, it's an exclusive service. God wants us to do it, but He wants us to do it in a proper way. He wants us to worship and serve Him. Another reason why God may demand our service, for we're His by reason of creation. He created us. He gave us life. When God created us, He didn't create us without a purpose. There are a lot of people in this world who don't know what their purpose is. Their purpose toward God. They've changed their purpose. They have taken upon themselves to determine what their purpose is. But God created each and every one of us for a purpose. Psalm 139, verse 13 through 14. For you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. That's David talking about what God has done and how God takes an interest in each and every one of us. So we are His because He created us. Because He created us with the purpose of worshiping and serving Him. But we are also, especially us as Christians, are His by reason of regeneration. Regeneration. For all the sin becomes short of the glory of God. That's Romans 3:23, right? Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. What has He done? He's regenerated us. When we walked away and we started serving Satan, or started serving the world, or started really serving ourselves exclusively, by means of the truth, by means of understanding that He is our Creator, we owe Him something, and that we stand in danger of judgment because of the choices we've made, He gives us that opportunity to be regenerated, to be brought back to our original purpose of worshiping and serving God. Galatians 3:26 through 29, For in Christ Jesus you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male or female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. What does that mean, we're Abraham's offspring? Remember, he's the father of the faithful. And when we put our trust in God and we obey the gospel and we're baptized for the remission of sins, we are regenerated. And we're acting just like Abraham acted, in that he did what God asked him to do. He wasn't perfect. But look at those big ones. Look at what Abraham was able to do, so God could know that by faith he would obey. So we're his. By reason of creation, by reason of regeneration, but something even more important. He controls life. He determines our lives. He controls, in some places it's called the silver cord, in other places it's called the golden bowl. That's kind of like, you know, when the golden bowl is broken or the silver cord is broke, that's life ending. But the use of precious metals there, to explain that, talks about the preciousness of life, even this life. You know, there's still something about this life that God looks at and says, it's very important what we're doing. Here this morning in worship, when we walk out those doors and the service that we give to God throughout the week, it's still so very important. It's just not about what's on the other side. So we can see the preciousness in that. But here, this life isn't going to last forever on this earth. There's going to be a time we're called into judgment. Acts chapter 17, verse 28. And this is the Apostle Paul talking to the philosophers on Mars Hill. But he tells something. Now, here's one of those. I don't want to say an absolute truth, but I'll say a universal truth. Okay? I think it's absolute, but more in this sense, universal. Because Paul's arguing with them about the nature of God and the nature of man. And he says, for, and here's a quotation, in him we live and move and have our being, unquote. As even some of your own poets said, quote, for we are indeed his offspring, unquote. How did those Gentiles know that about God? And look how many gods they had. How many they worshiped. But even some of them recognized, this can't be true. All these gods, this panoply of gods, it can't be right. Here's what has to be right. In him we live and move and have our being. For we are indeed his offspring. I like it better than said, we are his creation. And he has control over life and death. So we owe him something. We owe him service. Our service to God ought to be something very special. Now notice up here I got the S underlined. So pay attention to the underline when we go down through this. I'm going to try to hit these pretty quickly. Our service to our God ought to be sincere. You know what sincere means? The etymology of the word means without wax. Sincere furniture is furniture that doesn't have any wax. What does that mean, doesn't have any wax? Well, when the furniture maker is making a piece of furniture and he wants to make a fine piece of furniture that's worth a lot of money, that somebody's going to pay him for making it, He makes that furniture, and if there's a blemish in it, he might want to cover that blemish up with a little bit of wax. I don't know, there's something I think that car dealers get that they put on a car on their lot, and you can't see the little dents and the little bad place, marred up places in it until you take it home and it rains and then, you know, you wash it off or whatever, and then all of a sudden you see it. So, but this is what you do with that furniture. But that's the way it is with us all. Also, sincere. Our service to God ought to be without wax. Okay? And that means, in a sense, that when we tell God, I'm here to serve you, God, that's what we ought to be doing. Not just simply picking and choosing what we want to do. Now, it's going to be based on the opportunities that we have. What does God put in front of us that we can do? But we should be sincere in the sense that I really want to serve my God. 1 Peter 1:21, for to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving for you an example, so that you might follow in his steps. Jesus was always sincere about what he was doing. Sincere. No wax there, right? Here's the way it is. Just lay it on the line. And that's the way we need to lay our lives on the line. James 1. Verses 21 through 25, therefore put away all filthiness and rampant wickedness, and receive the word getting into our lives, permeating it, like the leaven in a lump of dough. The leaven works its way through. God's word will work its way through us if we'll get it in there, and we'll pay attention to it, we'll think on it and all, and that's what we're supposed to do. But that's not all we're supposed to do. But be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away and at once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty. Hey, you know what that is? That's the New Testament. That's for us today. And perseveres, he carries on, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. So that's the sense of sincere service toward God. Let's not forget whose we are and what we think even that we ought to look like. Our service to God ought to be energetic. Energetic. And that's a beautiful thing there. I really want to throw in enthusiasm, but I think I've got that on down here. So be ready for that when it comes up. Ecclesiastes 9:10, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all, do it with your might, for there is no work or thought or knowledge or wisdom in Sheol or in the grave to which you are going. When this body's dead, it's dead. This body isn't going to do any good works in the grave. But you know, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 10 says we will be judged on the deeds that we've done in this body. And we're not going to be able to do them in the grave. It's going to be too late then. We better be doing them now. So we better put some energy behind it. We need to get on the move. It's like that one commercial that we see, Benjamin Franklin captured electricity in a bottle. I never really thought of that. Yeah, I knew he had the kite and all the flying, but I guess he had a bottle there, and it was almost like there was a filament in that bottle that lit up when the lightning hit the kite. He invented the light bulb. There, I get it out. I wanted to say he invented electricity, but God did that. he kind of invented the light bulb there, if you really think about it, if that commercial's correct. That's energy. Mark 12:30. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Man, am I a failure? I'm going to have trouble. better.
Okay.
And yes, it is up to me to supply the energy and the sincerity in serving God. Our service ought to be, come on, ready. A ready service. How many times have you seen television shows, movies, plays, whatever, where somebody rings a bell and the servant comes running? I think I told you all before about Target in Waxahachie, they put in the little push button thing at the electronics. If there wasn't somebody there to wait on people, push the button, it alerts somebody, and they're supposed to come help you within 1 minute. And Jeremy and I were there, and he was wanting something, a game or something, so I pushed the button, and almost immediately, here comes a guy running. He's got tools all over him, and he's jingling. Way down, he comes up, hits that button to shut it off. How can I help you? I'll get it tomorrow. I'll do it tomorrow. God, I'll do it tomorrow. You know what the problem tomorrow is, right?
Never comes.
Never comes. Because by the time it does today, we're still waiting for tomorrow. So it's got to be ready. We've got to be ready to serve our God. Acts 21:13, then Paul answered, "What are you doing, weeping and breaking my heart? For I'm ready not only to be imprisoned, but even to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus." Yeah, he was ready to die. God wasn't ready for him to die. Jesus wasn't ready for him to die. He just go on for a little bit more. But you see the readiness. Are we ready to serve? 1 Peter 3:15, but in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect. Can knowledge sometimes make us arrogant? So we've got to be careful, remembering where we are from. But again, prepare to make a defense. We can't be ready at every moment if we're not prepared. 1776, July 4th, okay? That comes with some consequences in culture and society and the nation. Remember who the Minutemen were? The Minutemen? They were prepared to grab their muskets and be ready to fight within a minute. But they were prepared. They were prepared, and that's the only way we can be ready is to be prepared. We've got to do the groundwork ahead of time, but that's what our service ought to be. Our service ought to be voluntary. Okay. Now, I'm saying that in the sense of willing. You don't have to, you get to. And I've talked before about how that, yeah, in many churches, it's you know, I'll volunteer to do something. No, it's not. This is not being volunteers. This is voluntary in the sense that I am a disciple of Jesus Christ and I've got duties to perform. That's the voluntary part of it. I willingly accept the challenge of what God is asking me. So 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 7 through 8, each one must give as he has decided in his heart. Well, yeah, until we decide to do it, we're not going to do it. Not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and that's the voluntary that I'm talking about right there. And God is able to make all grace abound to you so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. And you know, sometimes the good works don't cost us a dime. Don't cost us a dime. They cost us a little bit of time. They cost us some aggravation. We'll do more of that tonight. It's a nice lesson. But sometimes it's just walking through life being helpful. Our service ought to be in Jesus' name. And in a sense, for Jesus' name. Not for me. Not even for the congregation. Jesus. Colossians 3:17, whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. Oh, can I sin if I say it's in the name of Jesus? Well, no, because it's really mean by the authority of Jesus. What does Jesus want me to do? Well, in word, there are things He wants me to do in word, and there are things He wants me to do in deed. Okay? So I've got to be careful, because He is my master. He's our master. We are His servants. And there He is. Let's do it in His name. 1 Peter 4:16, yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in that name. Yeah, because sometimes people won't appreciate your service. And sometimes people will take advantage of your service. You got to be careful. But yet, there it is. It's up to us to do the right thing, regardless of the attitude or the intentions of the other person. Our service ought to be continuous. You know, I've done this for... I'll use myself as an example. I've preached for 32 years. I think I'll just retire from preaching. Well, I could retire from preaching, but I can't retire from being a Christian, a disciple. I can't retire from my service to God. That's going to continue on and on. And so, Jesus explains it. Luke 9:23, and He said to all. Now, who was there? Let's see, there were some disciples there. There were some people there who just followed along. They were the crowd. There were some enemies there. All kinds of people there. But He said to all of them, if anyone would come after Me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow Me. So it's a continuous service. Now, did Jesus serve God every day? Remember, there were times when Jesus had to go by Himself up into the mountains to get away, and He had to take His disciples with Him sometimes to get them away because there were so many crowds and so many challenges. Come on up here. We need a rest. We need to. But even in that, in the rest, He was serving God. Well, does that have something to do with, like, the Sabbath day of the Old Testament? On the Sabbath day, when they were not supposed to do any work, wasn't that serving God? Yes, it was. So even in the times when they say, I got to have a little break here, I got to take some time for myself, even that is serving God, because it's beginning to serve ourselves. And what was it Jesus said? We're to love our neighbor as ourselves. Man, if I can't love myself and take care of myself, how can I love and take care of my neighbor? We're going to learn that first. And then, but there's that contingency. And our service ought to be efficient. Efficient. The very best. 2 Timothy 2:15. Paul tells Timothy, one of his chief pupils, okay? Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth. And that talks a lot about studying the Bible and knowing and understanding the Bible, but yet it's also true about the things we do in our everyday life as we seek to serve God by serving others. Rightly handling the word of truth. what God expects of me in all of this. And from that effective, I'm going to drop back here, and that energetic, another word that we could use there would be enthusiastic. Enthusiastic. And that word enthusiastic comes from the Greek, and it means God inside. In the Theos. God within. And when we have God within, our service is going to be enthusiastic. It's going to be energetic. We're going to be able to keep on going on, be that continuous service, because we know that God is at the very starting point of it with us. So, what God expects from us in His service ought to be accomplished through our delight in serving Him. How many of us do things that we don't delight in? Every now and then. Don't like washing those dishes, do you, G.W.?
Dusting.
That's another one. Say, don't like that, but it's got to be done, doesn't it? And we understand that. And there are things that God asks us to do that we just might not like to do. But if God is our delight, and serving God is our delight, we're going to want to do it, whatever it is. Psalm 40, 6 through 8, and sacrifice an offering you have not delighted. It's not what we bring to this table or throwing that little plate over there that's so important to God. Now, that's important for our attitude and our worship to God, but that has little to do in how God really looks at us. Because whether we put a dime in there or we put $1 million in there, it doesn't matter. It's about the attitude. But you have given me an open ear. Burnt offering and sin offering you have not required. Then I said, behold, I have come, and the scroll of the book that is written with me, I delight to do your will. I delight to do your will. There it is. I delight to do your will. Oh my God, your law is within my heart. See that, if you're following along, but you have given me an open ear. Have you ever sung that song about pierce my ear? In the Old Testament, under the old law, if a man had a servant, okay, a slave, that slave would have to be released at the year of Jubilee, or perhaps even at the sabbatical year, that have to go away. And but as that man or woman, usually a man, had been a slave, there might have been another slave there, a woman whom his master had given him as a wife. And they had children, they had a family. And not only that, the master was really good to him. And if the master said, hey, it's time. You fulfilled your contract. You're free to go if you want to. And the man said, but listen, I have to leave my wife. I have to leave my family. And you are such a good master. I want to stay with you. The master would take him to the doorpost, and they put the lobe of his ear up against the doorpost to take an awl and drive a hole in it. And that was to signify that that man had decided that he was going to be a servant to that master for all of his life. My ear, you have given me an open ear. But that was because he said, I want to serve you. We've said we want to serve our God. And our God has recognized that. Now we've got to carry out our service to God. May we always delight in serving our God and our Creator. Because it's so important. is so good. It's a good life, and it's for each and every one of us. Tonight we'll talk about what we serve, not who and how, but just why. What can we do? And I hope you look forward to that. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your attention. Have it eat. Let your request be made known as it stands the same to you today.